Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to Pine Beach Chapel. I have to apologize. The guy that was cutting the tree down so we'd have wood to burn for heating here quit. No, actually, the heat was on. The doors were shut. So if you'd rather be in there and it's warmer, you can. You don't have to look at my face, neither. So there might be a plus. All right, let me give you my opening greeting. A sweet, sweet grandmother telephoned St. Joseph Hospital. She timidly asked, "Is it possible to speak to someone who could tell me how a patient is doing?" The operator said, "I'll be glad to help you, dear. What's the name in the room and the number of the patient?" The grandmother, in her weak, tremulous voice, said, "Norma Findlay, room 302. The operator replied, "Let me put you on hold while I check the nurse's station for that room." A few minutes later, the operator returned to the phone and said, "I have good news. Her nurse just told me that Norma is doing well. Her blood pressure is fine. Her blood work just came back normal. And the physician, Dr. Cohen, scheduled her to be discharged tomorrow." Grandmother said, "Thank you. That's wonderful. I was worried. God bless you for all the good news." The operator said, "You're more than welcome. Is Norma your daughter?" "No, I'm Norma Friday in room 302. No one tells me anything." Words of wisdom. The highest form of worship is the worship of unselfish Christian service. The greatest form of praise is the sound of consecrated feet seeking out the lost and helpless. Billy Graham. Chris? Prayer together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Case to God, he says. This is Job's bold confrontation with God. In Job 13 is a testament to the power of faith in the human spirit amidst suffering. Job's courage to question the divine, seeking truth and understanding, is a potent reminder of the power of the genuine communication with God. Even in our deepest suffering, we can seek to question God boldly with a pure heart. Nowhere in Scripture does it say you can't argue with God. Not that you're going to win the argument, but you can argue with him. You can question him. You can approach him with anything you choose. And that's a great thing, because sometimes our complaining is all we need to do to feel a little bit better. And over the course of my lifetime, I've noticed all of us are pretty good at that. Without being taught, we know how to do it well. I especially. So let's start with verses 1 through 5. Yes, I have seen all this with my own eyes, heard and understood it with my very own ears. Everything you know, I know. So I'm not taking a backseat to any of you. He's arguing here with his friends that came to comfort him, that did a lousy job at that. But now he's gotten to the point of being aggravated. He's got questions with God, why these things are even happening. And he has questions with his friends, who supposedly were going to help him, and they've made him feel worse than when he started. Job here complained against the claim of superior knowledge on the part of his friends, to them, especially to Zophar. The situation seemed to be so simple, therefore Job must be somewhat ignorant to see what they have believed and what was easy to see. Remember, their excuse all along, and all three were in agreement, is Job sinned. His children sinned. That's why he's being punished, when that was not the case whatsoever. Job here developed a theme that would end with the vital demand that God make sense of his suffering. God's response to Job's demand and Job's response to God's response makes up at least the last 10 chapters of the Bible. I'm taking my case straight to God Almighty. I've had it with you. I'm going directly to God. So he's telling his friends, that's it. No more arguing with me. I don't believe what you're saying. I'm taking my argument to God. I'm going to get an answer. If not, I surely am not in agreement with what you feel about me. I'm not a sinner. God knows I'm a righteous man. You graffiti my life with lies. You're a bunch of pompous quacks. That's from The Message, the way he explains it. A good way to put it, naturally, the way we would speak. The same devastating frustration that led Job to wish he were dead now leads him in a bitter response to his friend's accusations. He begins with, I wish you'd shut your mouths. Silence is your only claim to wisdom. Listen now while I make my case. Consider my side of things for a change. Or are you always going to stay on his side, on God's side, seeking his service, to make up stories to get him off the hook? Why do you always take his side? Do you think he needs a lawyer to defend himself? How would you fare if you were in the witness stand? Your lies might convince a jury, but would they convince God? He reprimanded you on the spot. If he detected a bias in your witness, doesn't his splendor put you in awe? Aren't you afraid to speak cheap lies before him? Your wise sayings are knick-knack wisdom, good for nothing but gathering dust. He's really hurting, and he's really disgusted with his friends. When you think that these things should be helpful, like a call in the middle, sometimes we do feel this way. We're really, our friends don't have the correct answers, but we expected them to. And in this particular case, Job is that way. He feels that way. A commentary note on what I've just read, 1 through 12. With personal preference, Job declared that he did not need to be taught by them. Those who disgrace or disagree are tempted to magnify themselves and lower their colleagues more than is acceptable. So he sees a logic here. When intimidated or distressed with the fear of wrath, the force of temptation, or the weight of affliction, we should apply to our physician of our souls, Jesus Christ, who never rejects any, never prescribes inappropriately, never leaves any case uncured. To him we may speak anytime we choose, 24/7. To broken hearts and wounded consciences, all creatures without Christ are physicians of no value. We need to turn to Christ when we need him the most. We need him the least at any time. He tells us to approach him with our requests about anything and any time. We have a tendency to turn to Christ last. We first figure we can control the situation. Then we put ourselves in the position where everything will work out well. So we apply to our friends for help. We try to change things on our own, and when nothing works, we go, oh, the Lord, please hear my prayer. I need your help now. When we should have started there. And Job, doing it the right way in the beginning, has now gotten to the point where he forgot that. He's turned to his friends and they've helped him with lies, opinions that don't agree with his. And you've got to remember, during this entire time, he does not know that this is a test that he's going through. Sometimes we don't know it's a test we're going through. Sometimes what happens to us and drags us down and beats us up, whether it be physically or mentally or spiritually, is a test we're going through. God will be there for you if you call out. Job eventually speaks with a very angry attitude against his friends. They had advanced some truth which nearly began to concern him. But with a heart unhumbled before God, never modesty receives the criticism of men. When we approach God unhumbly, without showing who we are in the presence of the Almighty, the end result is usually a failure. You can bank on that. Verses 13 through 19. So hold your tongue while I have my say. Perhaps at this point Job's friends tried to interrupt him or said their own words of protest, but Job demanded the right to finish his statement. He goes on to say, then I'll take whatever I have coming to me. It's a little on the cocky side here, but sometimes when you think you're right, you get that way. Goes on in verse 14, why do I go out on a limb like this and take my life in my hands? Because even if he killed me, I keep on hoping I'll defend my innocence to the very end. This is the attitude that Job, through his past and present crisis, has succeeded. He didn't understand any of the situation and felt that God was against him. And at the same time, he could still exclaim, yet I will trust him. So no matter what, he never loses faith and trust. We all go through things. I'm not the only person that's ever gone through problems. But sometimes when they're really horrendous, you want to blame God. You want to expect that God should have realized you're in a situation that you can't handle alone. Where is he? He's left me. He can't hear my requests through. He's always there. I've never found myself leaning that way. I have a tendency to blame myself for what's wrong, and I'm probably 100% right. Usually I am at fault. It isn't ever God at fault, but you need to turn to him when you need him. Verse 16, just wait. This is going to work out for the best. My salvation. If I were guilt-stricken, do you think I'd be doing this, laying myself on the line before God? You'd better pay attention to what I am telling you. Listen carefully with both ears. Now that I've laid out my defense, I'm sure that I'll be acquitted. He has great confidence that God knows what's going on, and he'll be justified as innocent. Still not knowing it's been a test. But there's much to be learned during this test. Before his crisis, Job believed himself to be a blameless and upright man, as indeed it said in Job 1:1 and Job 1:8. He steadfastly clung to his belief throughout all of his experience and calamity, and through all the protests and arguments of his friends. Even before God, he would defend his own ways, not in arrogance, but in determined connection with reality. Can anyone prove charges against me, he says? I've said my piece, I rest my case. In one sense, it seems that Job felt that this determined connection to truth and reality was all he had. He had lost everything, including the sense of spiritual well-being. All he had was the truth, and he felt that if he let go of that to simply stop the argument or to please his friends, he would perish. His whole battle was based on his truth. And we need to stand there too. Sometimes we hear the argument, let's plea bargain. You're innocent, I know, but just take a look at the situation we're in. You're going to lose this battle. There's too much strength coming against you. So let's plea bargain. Let's just say you're sorry for doing it, and you did do it, but you'll never do it again, and we'll get you a lesser charge. As much as that may seem to make sense worldly, Do you really want to accept the fact that you're going to claim you're guilty when you were innocent? Or are you going to stand there and take the battle head on? Taking the battle head on may mean you're going to spend time behind bars, depending on what the situation is. And if it's a much lesser case, you're still going to lose ground. Job didn't plan on that whatsoever. His plan was to stand on his truth. He believed in himself. Verse 20, please, God, I have two requests. Grant them so I know I can count with you. First, lay off the afflictions. He's still sitting in a pile of ashes, still soothing his body that itches with a piece of broken clay. Listening to his friends, he's headed up to here. And he's calling out to God, can you back off with this? I can't take much more. We've had times when we felt like that. Physical pain and suffering, too much. Mental stress, too much. First, lay off the inflections. The terror is too much for me. Second, address me directly so I can answer you. Or let me speak and then you answer me. And he's putting up a pretty fierce argument here with God. What does that show us? We can argue with him. He doesn't mind it. You're not going to win, but you'll feel better. Sometimes arguing back is all that we need to feel a little bit better. And if you take notice, no matter how much you argue and how loud you get, you're not going to hear God hollering back. He'll answer you. You'll know you've been answered, but you won't hear him hollering. So go ahead, take a shot. Job resolved to hang on to the testimony his own conscience gave of his decency. He depended upon God for justification and salvation, two great things we hope for through Christ. Material salvation, getting back all that he had lost, he had not expected. Going into the argument, he knew he lost everything. He didn't expect to get that back. He just wanted a little peace and resolve. But of his eternal salvation, he was very confident that God would not only be his Savior to make him happy, but his salvation in the sight and pleasure of whom he would be so happy. He knew that he was not a hypocrite, and he concluded that God should not reject him. We should be well pleased with God as a friend, even when he seems to that he's against us as a disciplinary. God teaches us that even when he needs to discipline us, not punish, discipline, it's for our good. So sometimes these things grow us very well. And sometimes the only way God can reach you is through this process. We think that if God could actually sit at the foot of our bed and tell us what we did wrong and we should be sorry, that would be enough. We would change our ways, but we don't. How many times have you asked God to forgive you for sinning the same way you've sinned before and asked God for forgiveness before? We are human. We make mistakes and sometimes we repeat them. We must believe that all the work for good to us, even it will all work out that way, even when sometimes it seems to be against us. Romans 8:28-30, and I love 8:28. And we know with great confidence that God, who is deeply concerned about us, causes all things to work together as a plan for the good of those who love God, to those who are called according to his plan and purpose. For those whom he foreknew and loved and chose beforehand, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son and ultimately share in his complete satisfaction, sanctification, so that he would be the firstborn, the most beloved and honored among many believers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. Those whom he called, he also justified, declared free of the guilt of sin. And those whom he justified, he also glorified, raising them to a heavenly dignity. When you think of what Christ went through, imprisoned for 9 months in Mary's womb, he left heaven for that. And then he's born into this world for a world of leisure and pleasure. Oh no, that's not the way it worked out. He preached the truth and was rejected because of it. He suffered, died, went to the cross, and was raised 3 days later from the dead, all for us. And he was guiltless. Job's arguing here a very good argument, and we know it's a test, but he wasn't guiltless. No man ever born is guiltless. Because of the sin that Adam and Eve put upon us, it changed our nature. That's why the first thing we teach our children is no, no, no. We never stand there saying yes. Oh, wonderful, yes. That's not how we learn. And we spend most of our life hearing no. We're more concerned with what am I not allowed to do? Because in my own head, everything is good for me. Everything is free and easy. So just tell me the things that I shouldn't do. But Christ, he took all that on for us. Job doesn't know what's ahead for Christ. This is well before Christ is born. But he isn't a part of a test. We must hold on to God's promises. Even though at times, because we are so connected to ourselves and this world, we feel there isn't comfort in them. Sometimes the promise just sounds like a bunch of words. Oh yeah, God said this and this and this. I know I believe it to a degree. If I have to apply it, that's different. It's not fair. It's not fair. Why was I born at the person I am? Why couldn't I be born to a rich family, a family in great shape financially, living a life of luxury, not having to worry, getting the best of everything? We all feel that way at times. That's our nature. Christ never felt that way. He did what his Father wanted him to do for us. Verse 23, how many sins have been charged against me? Show me the list. How bad is it? Why do you stay hidden and silent? Why do you treat me like I'm your enemy? Why kick me around like an old tin can? Why beat a dead horse? You compile a long list of mean things about me, even hold me accountable for the sins of my youth. You hobble me so I can't move about. You watch me every move I make and brand me with a dangerous character. Like something rotten, human life quickly decomposes. Like a moth-eaten shirt or a mildewed blouse. No. Matthew Henry, theologian, you've heard him before, expresses the commentary by saying this. Job begs to have his sins revealed to him. A true remorseful person is willing to know the worst of himself, and we should all desire to know what our transgressions are, that we may confess them and guard against them for the future. Job complains sorrowfully of God's severe dealings with him. Time does not wear out the guilt of sin. When God writes bitter things against us, His design is to make us bring forgotten sins to mind so that we too repent of them as to break us off from them. As we should teach young people, beware of indulging in sin. Even in this world, they may enjoy the sins of their youth as to have months of sorrow for moments of pleasure. Their wisdom is to remember their Creator in the early days, their youth, that they may have assured hope and sweet patience of conscience as their consolation in their declining years. Job also complains that his present mistakes are strictly noticed. So far from this, God deals not with us according to our rewards. This was a large language of Job's melancholy views. I couldn't say it when I was younger because I had yet my life in front of me. But now that I've gotten older and some wisdom has seeped its way in, probably against my fighting it, I do remember what I did learn when I was younger, and they were the correct things. And I do lean down on now. I think to myself, God was good to me. He's blessed me in so many ways that I don't deserve. I'll make it to the end. He'll be with me. And when the end comes, I'll step over to the other side and I will be blessed for all of eternity. Something I really don't deserve. And it's not fake humility that says that. It's complete knowledge of my past. I don't deserve what's in front of me. I do know where I'm heading, to a place that's so great that my mind couldn't understand it. So there's very little written about heaven itself. But I do know that it's the place where I will go, spend eternity with Christ. Lots of us are going to, but so many have chosen the other route, the wide roadway, the highway to hell, as opposed to that small single lane path to heaven. But what a blessing it is for us that do know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, that do put our faith in Him and our trust in Him for everything. Job needed that so bad. He kept thinking about how good of a person he had been. And he has a right to think that way, to some degree. He was a good man. God said he was righteous. That's a lot to say. But at the same time, he did not know he was being tested, and that that test would grow him. As Paul writes in Romans, everything that occurs to us, everything that God puts upon us, is for a reason. And it's only going to make us better and bless us in the end. If God marks our steps and narrowly examines our paths in judgment, both body and soul feel His righteous vengeance. This will be an awful case of unbelievers, yet there is salvation devised, provided, and made known in Christ. Sometimes we sit back and say to ourselves, you know, I just wish I could get the point across. They just don't hear me. We know, those that have known Christ as their Savior, what it's all about. And we try so hard to get the point across to a friend or someone we care about, a relative, and it just seems like they've turned everything off. You can't reach them. You need to, but you can't. And the funny thing, you get excited about certain things. Chris said to me before, Ohtani, the baseball player, Japanese, comes from Japan. Shintoism is the main religion, but not his family. His family are Christians. He knows the Lord Jesus Christ, their Savior. I went, wow, didn't know that about him. He's on the team. How cool, how wonderful. And it is. It's great to know some are listening and some are experiencing and some are going to be there in heaven with us. And we just feel crushed that we can't reach out and tell everyone how exciting it will be for you also if you just have your faith in Christ. But this is what we learn from Job. We see, and he was a righteous man. I can easily say I'm not a righteous man, never was a righteous man, but I'm a thankful man. Let's close in prayer. Holy Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who has blessed us so deeply with our salvation. And we pray for those that we know that are still rejecting him. We pray that somehow, Lord, we'd have the words to say at some point, or someone else we know would have the words to say that would lead them to Christ, that they would put their faith in Christ. But at least we know at this time, even if we can't do that, we do have prayer. And we pray for all those we know that have not sought Christ as Lord and Savior. And we pray these things in his holy and precious name, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Forever, author of salvation.
Yes.
I don't know, a couple weeks ago I mentioned my friend Joe Barrett that I work with needed a lot of prayer and was getting a unknown tumor removed from his lung. And I'm happy to report that everything was a success. He came back to work this week and I put a new pile of work on his desk for him. So he's doing good. Well, it's good to hear.
So now we know why you prayed.
Yeah.
Anyone else? Let's keep Patty in prayer as she has a wonderful flight back home. When she's due back home?
Friday.
Keep Joe in prayer. I haven't heard anything new. I'll speak to him probably later on today. Hopefully the pneumonia is disappearing, unless someone knows anything about him. Other.
Carolina.
Yes, Carolina, Florida, all the areas that were devastated. It's quite for real, it's quite damaged, and they need our prayer as much as they need anything. So let's keep them in prayer. Anyone else? Let's close in prayer. Holy Father, we ask you to bless our military, our police, our medical workers, our firemen, all those behind the scenes that we do not see, that we know are working all the time, 24/7, watching over us. Protect them, Lord, as they walk into disastrous areas, as they need your help. We pray for the body of Christ throughout the world, the true body of Christ, Lord, that carries your word, your message, into areas where they're not appreciated to any degree. We pray for the church in China, one of your greatest movements, largest in size and overwhelmed by a rule that hates you, but your strength is there with them. Give them the blessing. And watch over us, Lord, and all our members. Bless this church, keep it safe as we continue to honor and praise you. In your holy and precious name, Jehovah God, and in your Son's name, Jesus Christ, and by the power and strength of the Holy Spirit, amen.
And do not be conformed to this world any longer with its superficial values and customs, but be transformed and progressively changed as you mature spiritually by the renewing of your mind, focusing on godly values and ethical attitudes, so that you may prove to yourselves what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect in His plan and purpose for you. From the book of Romans 12:2, may God add to us all understanding of this His holy word.
Down to